Hi guys.
So I'll explain a little bit the guidelines first of the webinar, because it's the first webinar in a cycle. So I'll show this every week, actually. I'm Gino. I will introduce myself in the next slide. This is Eric from Caldic, who is a moderator. Normally, you also see him on camera, but he has some difficulties in getting in. So for some reason, there's some blockage or something in his office, so he cannot enter properly. So what normally, and then there's of course you guys, what normally, I'll get my pointer out. So what we normally do is I do around 45 minutes presentations, and then afterwards there's always room for questions. If possible, leave your questions for after the presentation. If you have an urgent question, normally you can ask Martin or Eric via the chat, but at this moment Eric is not in, so you cannot ask him. Normally they can give you access live if you want, via just by clicking a button, and in this case I will need to do that myself. So it's best that if you have a question for this webinar, please just put it in the chat, and I will, you know, look at it on the side when a question comes in. I will try to answer it. So first about me, because it's the first webinar, I only do this once. Don't worry, I'm Gino. And I just selected some pictures to properly introduce myself. I studied chemical engineering in Eindhoven, and then biotechnology in Wageningen. And also in Wageningen, I did my PhD, actually not on beer, but on vaccine process development against meningitis. After that, I went to Ghent University, where I worked on diatoms. And diatoms are saltwater algae, and this is a
hi.
Eric.
Hi.
I just explained. So, guys, if you have a question, you can put it in the chat, and then Eric can give you access. Eric, you do that by clicking the crown in the chat. You will see that.
Yeah.
So after that, I did another postdoc. On diatoms and on E. coli, and then after that I started working at Leuven University, where I started the Institute for Beer Research. I did that for about 5 years, and now since 3 years I'm working for Fermentis. So I have quite a solid background on cell metabolism, not only yeast, but also bacteria and algae, obviously. I also have some hobbies. These are shown here. I organize a festival each year, music and arts festival. And my second big hobby is brewing. And this is a picture of my brewery. I have a small one, obviously 35 liter with four fermenters, but they are all temperature controlled, which is quite nice. And as you will see also later on in the webinars, the importance of actually controlling your fermentation. So that's it for me. I don't know, Eric, if you shortly want to introduce yourself.
Yes, my name is Erik Stenberg. I work for Caldic in Norway. Ingredients for the beverage industry. I've been working there for 3 years now. So, yeah.
Perfect.
That's it.
Thanks, Eric. We already have a question coming in, actually, from Mintan. How can I get access? How can I get your presentation by file? You can't, actually. But after this webinar, you will receive an automatic email with the recording. So you can click a link and then you will enter the recording again. So all the webinars I will do will be available, all the recordings, during the course of the webinar cycle, so probably until the end of the year. The reason that we don't send around presentations is, and then you will notice that during the webinar cycle, is that we always are doing research, and so we get sometimes new insights in certain topics, or we have new information, and we don't want old presentations circling around the internet. We always want to have, you know, the latest information available. But for these webinars, everything will be available until the end of the year, if that's okay for you guys. So today I'm going to talk about production quality and shelf life of active dry yeast. It's the first one of a cycle. I just show that here. And as we go along in time, we will get into more and more detail. We will get more and more into science. Because the whole purpose of these webinars, which are all under the umbrella of the Fermenters Academy, is actually education. So we want to share what we learned from our yeast and to provide you, you know, with some tools to enable improvement of your brewing. So today is about production and quality. Before I start, I'll just quickly introduce Fermentis. Fermentis is based here in the Lille area. Lille is a beautiful city. It's very close to the Belgian border. So if you ever have the opportunity, please do visit, because all the Belgian beers are present in this city, even, you know, some special ones that you even do not get in Belgium. So it's quite cool. Our production facility for the brewing yeast is based in Ghent, which is about 40 minutes from Lille. So quite close together. Obviously, you are all in this beautiful area in Scandinavia. Next, Fermentis is actually a business unit of Le Safre. So I'll just shortly introduce Le Safre. It's a quite a big company, still family owned. So at present, we have almost 11,000 people working for Le Safre, more than 70 nationalities. We have 69 production sites in the world. And to give you an idea on the scale, one bread out of three in the world is made with a yeast from Le Safre. We have 59 applied research centers, 10 R&D centers, 570 people working in R&D. We work in 185 countries, and already for quite a long time, more than 165 years. So if you look at the businesses that Le Safre works in, it's split up into four sectors: food, taste and pleasure, industrial biotechnology, healthcare, and baking. Obviously, baking is a big portion of what we do, or what Le Safre does, actually. And that also explains the large amount of factories worldwide, because most of them are really focused on producing baker's yeast. We are in the business sector, food, taste and pleasure, Fermentis. So this is, you know, the business sector with most fun. So what do we do? We work only in the world of fermented beverages, not only beer, but also wine, cider, spirits, any drinkable alcohol that you can think of. We have a solution for that. Today, and in most webinars, I will mainly focus on beer, simply because the area that you are based in is not very good for wine. It is quite good for cider, so maybe at the you know, early next year, I'll also do a presentation on cider, but we'll see if there's interest from you guys. Today, I will talk about yeast, but we also have bacteria and yeast extracts and derivatives, obviously. One of them I will also discuss in the cycle of the webinars. So what is yeast? Yeast is a sexual organism, and in one of the later webinars I will explain a little bit more about this. It's quite small, 4 to 8 micrometers, and it belongs to the fungal clade. It's a fungus. In nature, there are around 200,000 species present. It's an estimate. Could also be 300,000 or 150,000. We don't know. It's an estimate. Actually, to be honest, I don't actually know how they get to these kinds of estimates, but it's indeed a large number, that's for sure. But industrially, so the strains that are available are only a very small portion of this natural diversity present, which is also kind of logical, because most yeasts are not really suitable for to produce beverages. So it comes down to a few hundred. I can't see or hear your video, I get from Jan. Is my sound off or? Okay. Well, Morten can, so Jan, probably there's something wrong on your side. So, two yeasts that are important for brewing are the Saccharomyces pastorianus, which is the lager yeast. It's bottom fermenting. It prefers cold conditions or somewhat colder, and it's for this reason it's quite slow. And then you have the ale yeast, which is the Saccharomyces cerevisiae, top fermenting. It prefers somewhat warmer conditions, and for this reason is. Fifteen active dry yeast now in the portfolio, so available on the market for brewing. Three lager yeasts and 12 ale yeasts. I will discuss many of them in the course of the webinar, and for some of them I will focus a bit more, like the LA01, which is for low alcohol, the DA16, which is for Brut IPA. But if you check the program, you will see when I discuss more. We also have now one bacteria on the market for kettle souring. It's a Lactobacillus plantarum. We have one functional product on the market now, which is Spring Blanche. Spring Blanche is a fermentation aid, actually. It's a yeast protein extract to create and maintain permanent haze in your beer. So if you have an issue with the haziness in your beer, you can add a little bit of this product, and your beer. Beer will remain hazy forever, I would say. Then we also, have fermentation aid, so yeast nutrients. But I will not go into that, because most breweries start from barley malt and don't need additional nutrients normally in their fermentation. So what do all the yeasts have in common? It's the alcoholic fermentation. And it's shown here in this very simplified reaction. What happens is, if you have a glucose molecule, is converted into ethanol and also into CO2. If you look at the ratio, it's about, in theory, 180 grams of glucose is converted into 88 grams of CO2 and 92 grams of ethanol. So it's kind of 1-to-1. If you look a little bit more closely, there are several equations. Most famous one is the one from Belling. And he found out empirically, actually, that if you convert 1 kilo of sugar, you make 484 grams of ethanol, 463 grams of CO2, and also 53 grams of yeast. So about 5% of the carbon, of the glucose that you put in, is converted into yeast, into biomass. Obviously, this is not the only thing that happens, producing ethanol and CO2, but a lot more is happening. As you all know, a lot of flavors are being produced during fermentation. And this is shown on this slide. You will see the slide also in many future webinars. So what happens is you have sugar outside the cell, it's transported inside and you make ethanol, but also, as I just mentioned, a lot of nice flavors. I will not go into all the flavors today, but two of them I can mention, isoamyl acetate, which is a typical fruity banana flavor, and ethyl acetate, which is the also a fruity flavor, but it has some solvent, nail polish like touch to it. These two flavors are produced by all the yeast, so both lager yeast and all the ale yeasts, but obviously in different quantities, and that's what also this yeast from each other. So to, you know, bring some sense in the options of the yeast, fermentation wise and flavor wise in particular, we came up with the idea to do experiments all under the same conditions. So fermentations and produce beer and then do a sensory analysis with our panel to determine where to position them on three axes. So we have the neutral axis, the fruity axis, and the spicy axis. What we did is we made a 15-plate wort. We bittered it with the iso alpha extract. We pitched all the yeast at 50 gram per hectoliter at 23 degrees. And the fermentations were done at atmospheric pressure. So if you do that, I don't know what's happening now. If you do that, and do the sensory analysis, you can position actually the yeast in this simplified representation of reality. And this is, we do this to give you an idea on, okay, if you want to make a very neutral lager, you go along the neutral axis and find that W3470 is the most neutral lager yeast that we have. If you want to make a more fruity, like blonde style beer, you go along the fruity axis and can select any of the fruity ones. If you want to have a very fruity one, you can go for S33. If you want to have more mild fruitiness, you can go for SO4. Obviously, this is only valid for this specific situation, because as I will show in webinar 3, if you change these conditions, also the blocks here with the yeast will move around. So you can actually make a fermentation more fruity or less fruity depending on the conditions that you choose. But as a starting point, this gives you at least an idea on where to start from. So most of our information that we have is present in the tips and tricks. I don't know how many of you already discovered the tips and tricks. You can download it here from our website. It contains a lot of information about specific kinetics, alcohol tolerance, ester profiles under these conditions. And again, like mentioned before, this is done in specific conditions just to give you an idea. To give you an example, if you see here the dotted line, which is USO5, it's done at 13.5 Plato and at 20 Plato, or 18 Plato, sorry. And as you can see, the fermentation time is quite long. USO5 is a slow grower, so it takes about, I don't know, 10 days, 2 weeks before the fermentation. So if you use USO5, and many of you guys do, and your fermentation is finished in 2 days, then you should wonder if something is wrong, because this is a slow yeast. And in the tips and tricks, you can see, okay, I can expect this or I can expect that. It's just an order of magnitude that we are presenting here. So it's very handy, I would say. So if you look at more closely at respiration of yeast, as I mentioned, in fermentation mode, glucose is converted into ethanol, but also two of these molecules are produced, because we are a yeast producer, and today I'm going to talk about the production of yeast. And obviously, as I just mentioned, you only produce about 5% of biomass and a lot of ethanol. This is not something that we want. We want to make biomass. So what we do is we propagate. And what happens in propagation is your glucose is converted in the end taken up and converted by the so-called oxidative phosphorylation. So it's burned basically to produce biomass. And what happens is that in the case of fermentation, let me do it like this, the excess electrons of glucose are accepted by an electron acceptor. And because there's no oxygen available, the final electron acceptor is ethanol. That's why yeast has to produce ethanol to be able to survive. Only two of these energy molecules, ATP, are produced, so this process is quite slow. Well, if there is glucose present, you produce biomass, and in this cycle, in this oxidative phosphorylation, you generate around 28 ATP, so 28 of these energy molecules. And this is different actually for every yeast, so this is a kind of an average value, which is close to or valid for most of the yeast, but there are some differences. So because of this, because you produce a lot more energy, also faster. So where do we do this? Where do we produce our biomass? I already mentioned it. It's here in our production facility in Ghent. It's next to a canal. So all transport of substrates and products is done by sea, by water. So what you see here are different tanks. These are tanks with molasses, because we grow our yeast on molasses, and obviously also other nutrients. I will explain later. Here we have the buildings that have all our propagators. So not fermenters, but propagators. Inside, I will show a picture later, and then here we have the packaging. So how does our process work? Well, we start in the laboratory, of course, at minus 80, where we take a pure culture from the freezer. We put it in a chest tube, and we grow the biomass actually to a certain amount, and then we scale up in volume to end up, you know, so we go from say a few million cells to a few hundred gram cells to a few hundred kilos to a few tons. For brewing, we stop here. So for the brewing yeast, we stop at this volume. For baker's yeast, we go a bit further, and we produce tens of tons at once in these massive fermenters. So I have a picture of this fermenter. It's shown here. Size-wise, this one is 3,000 hectoliters. So to give you an idea, and most of you guys, I don't know the size of your fermenters, but 3,000 hectoliters is quite a big one. Big difference with a fermenter, obviously, is that we blow in air. And the amount is really a lot. So you have a very vigorous system here to produce the biomass. So how does that work, the propagation in the propagator? Actually, what you do is we make more cells. And to make more cells, we duplicate actually the yeast. And all the yeasts are duplicated via the so-called cell cycle. So all eukaryotes have a cell cycle, so also yeast. And I'll quickly explain how that works. So it starts actually here at G0, that's called, which is actually the final of this step and the start of this step. So what you do in G1 is actually you increase the cell size. So you have a small cell which increases in size. And then at a certain point, you start initiating a bud. So you start initiating the synthesis of DNA, actually. Because in the end, you want to split the cell. So after the S phase, you go to the G2 phase, which is again a growth phase. So to grow the bud and also to enable the division of the split of DNA into to form two nuclei, actually. That happens in the mitosis phase, so the M phase. where you also divide the cells. So you have a new cell and you have a daughter cell, or the mother cell and the daughter cell. And obviously this one also goes again in a cell cycle. So that's how it works in terms of duplication of yeast. What we can do in our factory is actually stop in the G1 phase. So we use a fat batch propagation, which means that we feed nutrients during the process. And based on this feed and also the composition of this feed, we ensure that all the cells are in this phase, the G1 phase. What's so good about the G1 phase? Well, you have mainly single cells, and all these cells contain a lot of trehalose. Trehalose is a sugar, and this sugar is actually surrounding the enzymes, the transporters that are very important for fermentation later on. So it keeps the membrane proteins in the right configuration, so that the, as we call it, the doors for sugar assimilation are always open, also after drying. Because also in this G1 phase, a second important compound that is produced are the sterols. Sterols make the membrane more fluid. So as I will show in a few slides, what happens in the drying process is when you extract the water, obviously your cell will shrink, and you still want to have, you know, all your important transporters of your substrate intact. So to keep those intact, you need the trehalose, but also the membrane fluidity, and that's enabled by the sterols. So it's a two-step optimization that we do. First of all, we want to produce, you know, a lot of biomass. So to produce biomass as much as possible and as efficient as possible. But also in the second optimization is the biomass after drying should do exactly as what we want them to do. So in this case, make great beers. So back to the process. So I just discussed what happens in this fermenter. We go along, we centrifuge off of the biomass, we store the cream for a short period, and that's because the steps behind the storage are a bit slower, so we need some storage capacity. Then we dry it in this vacuum filter, and I have a picture of that. I will show it. So what happens is the yeast cream is sprayed on the surface of this rotating drum, and there's in the whole surface there is a vacuum, so you basically suck out all the surrounding water, and then you scrape this yeast off. So as you can imagine, this is all in contained rooms, so there's no people there, and it's all very hygienic, obviously. So what you get is these kind of I would say it looks like a cloth to clean the windows a little bit. So what happens then is after this, you extrude. So we make small particles of it, and then those are sent to the drying plant where we dry it and then we pack it. As you can see, we also do liquid yeast, normal, which is kind of logical, but not for the brewing or for any of the yeast suitable for fermented beverages. And this is mainly based on logistics. In the next webinar, I will also, and also in this webinar, I will show you that the dry yeast you can keep for a very long time, and this is obviously not valid for liquid yeast, as you know. So to be able, you know, to send around yeast all over the world, because breweries are everywhere, we decided to go for dry. So what do you see under the microscope before drying? So this is a sample taken just before the centrifugation, or just after, I should say. You see a nice ellipse form cell. You see here a bud, which is an old one. So this cell has done at least one duplication. And here you see another one. It's about 20 to 30% dry matter in this case. And you see it's smooth. Then we dry. And in the drying process, what we do is we extract all water. So not only the surrounding water, but also the water that is inside the cell. And as you can see, the cell is still intact. So it's just a little bit wrinkled. And this is technology, of course. This is the most important technology within the company, because it's very hard. If you try to do this yourself at home, the cell will break for sure. So in this phase, we have around 95% dry matter. And the membrane, as I mentioned, is intact. It's very important. What you see as a brewer, if you open a pack, is you see something. Well, you don't see this, but if you look under a like a very light microscope, you see these kind of granulates, like kernels. It's like a bit like milk powder, but with a little bit larger particle size. And in each of these kernels, there are hundred thousands of yeast cells, obviously packed together. In this phase, after that, we go to packaging. It's vacuum packed, mainly to preserve from oxygen, but most important from moisture. All you guys that opened a yeast pack and forgot about it and left it in the refrigerator, you will see it's hydrated extremely fast in a moist environment. So that's also the reason that you, once you open the pack, you have to use it, because it attracts also moisture from the air. It's so dry. Shelf life is 3 years for all our yeast, and today I will show you why that is. So in short, we start with a pure cultured yeast. We propagate it in several steps of increasing volume. We centrifuge, we restore, we do a first water removal in a rotating vacuum filter, and then we dry. So these are like dedicated state-of-the-art facilities. We do it in a fed batch way to ensure that all the cells are in the G1 growth phase. Obviously, we do it aerobically. At a certain moment, so in G1, to shape the yeast, best for both this part of the process, drying, but also for the fermentation afterwards. And what's important to realize is that each yeast has its own dedicated process. So, which means that, the feeds and composition of the fermentation medium is different, and also the control is different, because we optimized it for every yeast. Let's continue. Quality. So now you know how we produce it. And then, of course, we also look at quality. So to explain what we do before the yeast enters the factory is, and this is just an example, when we have a new yeast strain, we test first genetics, purity, and properties. So genetics means that we actually identify that we are working with the yeast that we want to work with. So we do an interdelta PCR, which is a technique that allows you to identify on strain level. So we know for sure it's the right strain. Purity. So obviously we look at contamination, if the cell line is pure. And we also look at properties. And in properties, you have to think on aging, on the composition, elemental composition, the dryness, how much nitrogen is in there, how much phosphorus, etc. And we also do vitality, so we check the amount of CO2 produced per time to see, okay, is this yeast performing as we expect it to perform? And that all happens in this so-called R&D collection. So from this collection, we start propagating if we want to produce it in the factory. And in all these steps, all these quality controls, all these measurements are being done. So in the end, we end up with a so-called daughter line yeast tubes. So, which means that we simply did a propagation to increase biomass, and we end up with a lot of tubes as starting material for the factory. So, important take-home message is: in all these steps, we have many controls, and the final cell line that enters the factory, we know exactly that it's the strain that we want. It has been identified genetically, and we know all the properties. So then it enters the production facility. And then, as I just shown on the slide, we have the laboratory phase to increase biomass concentration. And there we don't do genetics anymore, because we already found out that it's the exact strain that we want. We only do purity and control in the industrial phase and make biomass. Then we store it before we put it on the market, and we again do all kinds of tests: purity, composition, aging, properties. So we do fermentations before we put it on the market to know if it's behaving and performing as we expect and as it should perform. And then there's a positive quality release, and then you can buy it as a customer. So, you know, why are we doing so much purity checks? I will explain that just by briefly showing you the production process. I have to go back a few slides. So in all these phases, up until, you know, the first inoculation propagator, this is all done with sterile air. So it's completely pure. But starting from this volume, practically you cannot use sterile filtration anymore, because we need far more airflow than a sterile filter would allow to pass. So we do a so-called deep filtration here, which means that there is always the possibility that you have, you know, a bug flowing around in the air that can still enter your tank. So let's look at the quality that we are producing now. Showing first the ale yeast. So out of vats per gram, which is a lot. Then we look at lactic acid bacteria, acetic acid bacteria, pediococcus. So typical bacteria that you that are you know, around in the world and are important for brewing. These are all less than one, so CFU is colony forming unit. So it's a measurement to do cell count. So it's less than one cell per 10 to the 7th yeast cell, so 10 million cells of yeast. There should be less than one acid bacteria per 10 million yeast cells, etc. So if you calculate that back to the actual pitching rate, you have, if you pitch, say, at 50 gram per hectoliter, you have 5 million cells per milliliter. And in that, the possibility that in this amount, there's always less than one cell of I would say, bacterial contaminants. So this means there's less than one lactic acid bacteria for 10 million viable yeast cells. So if you calculate that, it means our purity is 99.999%. So you might wonder, is this a problem? Well, I can assure you it's not, because one bacteria will always lose from 10 million viable yeast cells. In particular, because in brewing you produce alcohol, most bacteria don't like alcohol, and you also add hops, and almost all bacteria hate hops and hate bitterness, so they don't grow at all. So this is impurity. It's very good. Then quality of lager yeast, it's exactly the same, 99.999%, but our viable yeast cell count is a little bit lower. It's 6 billion cells per gram of yeast, or more than 6 million. There can be a little bit variation. This is the minimal number that we put on the specification. So it's quite high, but a little bit lower, and that's because lager yeasts are a little bit harder to produce. So next question, how long can we store this yeast? So this is about the shelf life. So what we did is we taken fresh yeast, you know, immediately after packing, and we do so-called forced aging test, which is a test to mimic actually normal natural aging, but in a faster way. What happens is you vary temperature and time. You do several cycles to actually get similar or try to get similar conditions as what would happen in natural aging. We also do natural aging tests. I will show you results of that later. So this has been aged for you know, different times, and in both situations we check viability, we check fermentation performance, and at the end of the fermentation we check volatiles and ethanol production. So these are the things that are very relevant for you as a brewer. So let's look at the first example, SO4, where you see here on the x-axis the aging time. So this is forced age, so that's why we call it equivalent natural aging time, from fresh to 4 years. And then the viability on the y-axis between 0 and 100%. So at time zero, we have 100% viability, obviously. And then as you go along in time, you see that the viability goes down a little bit. But even after 4 years, you see in ales, you still have like 92% viability. So quite good. If you look at the kinetics, so this is alcohol production per time on the y-axis in standard conditions. So pitching rate 50 gram per hectoliter in a standard wort at 15 Plato's. And at 20 degrees fermentation temperature, you find this. This is an average of 5 batches of fresh yeast. And then if we look at aged yeast for 4 years, so the yeast with 90% 92% viability remain, you have this. So to put it more clear, I put them in one graph. You see that the differences are not that big. You see some so red is the aged, the blue is the fresh. You see some red dots a little bit more to the right, so a little bit slower, but in the end they all reach fermentation and final attenuation, same alcohol level. Then lager. So I put the lager, I put the data in one slide. So blue is fresh again and aged. If you compare the two, you see that in this case, after 4 years of aging of the W2470, it's a bit slower. You can see that clearly here. So now look at all the yeast, all the ale yeasts. And I show here the total time of fermentation on the y-axis for the different strains. You can see there's not much difference. At least there's no significant difference between all of them. If you have fresh, which is orange in this case, and if you have 4 years of aging. So this means that all in terms of fermentation time, ale yeast can be stored at least for 4 years. So there's no difference. If you look at the productivity, I will answer your question. I'm getting a question from Alexander in a few slides. So we also look at the ethanol production per day, because this is an important measure for vitality. And again, you see here there are you know, neglectable differences for all the ale yeast between fresh yeast and aged yeast. Then flavor, that will answer your question, Alexander. If you look here on the top left, esters production. So this is measured at the end of fermentation for the different yeast. You see in the case of fresh or aged yeast, there is no difference. So it's all the same. Produced ethanol, you see at the end of fermentation between fresh and aged yeast, there is no neglectable differences between them. Higher alcohols, which esters and higher alcohols are the main flavor descriptors. Also in this case, you see there is, you know, almost no difference or neglectable difference or not a significant difference, statistically at least, between fresh and 4 years of aging. So this is quite good news. Then if we look at bottom fermentation, so the lager yeast, I put them on one slide. So if you look at the final ethanol concentrations for the three lagers that we have, you see they all reach the same value, which means that there's no difference between fresh and aged. Aged is in this case red again. If you look at ester profile and higher alcohols, you find something very similar. You can see sometimes a trend, like, okay, it seems that the dried yeast is even, you know, produces even more higher alcohols, but statistically there is no difference. It could be a little bit better when dried, but you should look at this as statistically the same. So there's no difference. Then we look at the productivity per day. And as you already saw a few slides back on the fermentation kinetics of W3470, you see here there are some differences. In particular for 3470, you see that the productivity, so the ethanol production per day, is going down in this case. So which means that the fresh yeast is faster than an aged yeast. So in conclusion about forced aging, we can say and conclude that for the ale yeast, we find very solid results over 4 years of aging. There are no differences. That said, we still put the best before date on 3 years, and that's it's mainly based on the next one, the lager, because we saw that after 4 years of forced aging of the W3470, we see the fermentation slowing down. So that's why we said, okay, the best before date of the lagers is 3 years. And to keep it clear for everyone, the best we say the best before date for all the yeast is 3 years. So is there any chance to store something longer? So if you have an old yeast pack in the refrigerator, if it's an ale yeast and if it's, you know, past date, but you're still within these 4 years, I would say you can still use it. Don't use it to make bread, only if you like baking, but you can still make beer out of it, for sure. So for the model yeast, we identified in this case SO4 very robust, W3470 a little bit more sensitive. Then the impact of storage temperature on yeast vitality. This is a question we get a lot. Where do I put the yeast, in the freezer, in the refrigerator? Can I leave it at room temperature? So we did, again, a very extensive study. And in this case, we looked really at natural aging. So I'm showing now fresh yeast again, so immediately sampled after packaging. And then yeast that has been aged for 3 years and 8 months, so almost 4 years at minus 20, at 5 degrees, so in the refrigerator, and at room temperature 25 degrees. And again, we checked viability, we checked fermentation performance, and we did sensory analysis, we did tastings to ensure that we find the same things. So again, looking at SO4, top fermentation, I on the y-axis here you see the viability again, and here you see the three different storage conditions, so minus 25 and 25. Year zero is the reference, so it's 100%, and then if you store it for 3 years and 8 months at minus 20, you have about I would say 98% viability left. Stored in the refrigerator, you have around 95. Stored at 25 degrees, you also have around 95% viability left. If you look at the fermentation kinetics, in this case, I'm showing word gravity over time. So it goes down, obviously, comparing a fresh batch, which is here shown in orange, and the aged batches stored at 5, minus 20, and 25. And you see there's no difference. You see at this point, there's a little bit of a difference, but this is a normal biological variability. So there are no differences for the SO4 in this case. If you look at the sensory part, so again, green is at 5 degrees, stored at 5 degrees for 3 years and 8 months. Red, 25 degrees, and the orange is the fresh one. So as you can see here, the differences are very limited. It's these differences on a sensory scale are so small that that it's very, yeah, it's neglectable, I would say. Then for lager, again stored at minus 25 and 25 degrees, viability on the y-axis again, and there you see quite significant differences. So if you store a lager at minus 20, your viability will drop, and we measured a drop of around 20%, so the remaining viability is around 80%, which is still, it's still fine, but we found out that if you store it at 5 degrees, so in the refrigerator, you have 95% of viability remaining after 3 years and 8 months. And then at 25, you also see a drop. So lager yeast cannot be stored at room temperature, but also not really in the refrigerator. You have to put in the freezer. You have to put them in the refrigerator. Looking at the kinetics, again, W3470, you see, you compare a fresh batch and then 3 years and 8 months, so say almost 4 years at 5, after 4 years at minus 20, and after 4 years at 25. You see, you know, it's slowing down. It's going slower after 3 years and 8 months of aging in comparison with the fresh yeast. In particular, if you go at a higher temperature, so if you leave your yeast at room temperature for 3 years and 8 months, your fermentation will be slower. In the end, you know, the final gravity is very similar for all of them. So flavor wise, if you look at it and compare fresh between stored at 5 and 25, again, you see very limited differences. This is on a scale from 0 to 8, and they are all, you know, around, I would say, one maximum difference. And on a sensory scale, that is very low. You know, even an expert taster has difficulties. But in a big panel like we have with 40 tasters, you can discriminate and find these small differences. Overall, it's I would say neglectable, similar to the ales. So in conclusion, the active dry yeast that we produce, and I'm very confident to state that is the best on the market. We have a purity of 99.999%. And that, you know, is the best quality that you can get at this moment. There are no significant differences between fresh and forced aged yeast. The shelf life, we state, is 3 years, both for the ales and the lagers. But as I showed, you know, if you have an ale that is a little bit past date, you can still use it. Storage in cool, so preferably in the refrigerator around 5 degrees, and dry conditions, obviously. Aromatics production are not influenced between fresh and aged yeast, so the beer we produce from that tastes the same. Very important, I mentioned that early in the presentation, if you open a pack, you cannot use it. You have to use it immediately. You cannot store it for a very long time because it will attract moisture. And once you rehydrate the yeast, it wants to kick off and start fermenting, of course. In the next webinar, I will show you that the direct pitch is not impacted by aging. So all our yeasts are easy to use, and I will explain this in the next webinar, what that means, easy to use. Last but not least, I want to indicate that we have an app for especially designed for brewers, where you can find all kinds of information and tools about our product. I will explain in later webinars in more detail what type of information is in here. But you can find more than in this app and then actually in the tips and tricks. So it's a very nice tool. So the next webinar is next Friday, 16th, where I talk about rehydration versus direct pitching and what is the best. And with that, I'm at the end of my presentation. I really thank you for being present here. I would appreciate it if you do it via your computer and answer a very short questionnaire. Also, you can, if you have specific topics that you want me to address in future webinars, you can put that in this questionnaire. The reason I use questionnaires is because we do many webinars, and it's very hard to answer all of them individually by email. So the idea is that at the end of the cycle, I will gather all requests and information I got from the questionnaire and come up with new presentations about specific subjects that you are interested in. That's the idea. So questions, guys? No questions. Oh, Alex is typing something. Have you considered to sell packages in various weights? Yes, and we sell 11.5, 500 and 10 kilo packs. Maybe in the future there will also be intermediate sizes between 11.5 and 500. But at present, these are the three sizes that we have. Some products are packed in 100 gram, depending a little bit on the need of brewers. The reason that we don't have actually, you know, a massive amount of different pack sizes is because for each pack size you need a different packaging line, which is as you know in also in yeast production, it's very similar to beer production. The packaging line is a very expensive investment, so that's why we have these three sizes now. Oh, thank you, Alex. We have a question coming in from Tige. I hope I pronounce your name correctly. Have you considered more, so Tige asked the question, have you considered more strains, perhaps produced at smaller batches, slightly higher price, no problem. Thank you, Tige. Maybe it's a bit early to answer this question, because show you ground of our yeast and why we have the range that we currently have on the market available, why it's not bigger, like for instance, if you look at liquid yeasts. And the reason is that with the current range that we have, you can produce any beer style that you want to produce. If you want to, you know, have certain accents, certain flavors developed, you can also use a single yeast to produce this flavor by changing the conditions, for instance. So the philosophy of fermenters is that you can work in two ways. First, you can select a yeast, you know, that is very suitable for a certain beer style. So it's you focus on the yeast. But alternatively, you can also select the yeast and change conditions to be able to produce also another beer style. So it's with our current range of products, we can, I think, produce, say, 99.9% of the beer styles that are available on the market. And bear in mind that we produce, say, 5-6 tons at a time, which is a lot of yeast. And if you want to have a big range, like if you want to put 200 yeasts on the market, that will become too expensive. So commercially, that's not attractive to have, you know, all the yeasts possible available in dry form on the market. So Tige is typing a follow-up question. Oh, thanks, Tige. Yes, as I mentioned, so from next week onwards, we will go deeper and deeper. This was, you know, a good introduction of fermenters and fermented yeast. But as we go along, you will get more and more science presented. I see some more questions coming in. Jens and Jan are typing. Good. Thanks, Jens. Yes, Jan. Yeah, we were in contact already by email. So Jan wants to learn more about pitch rate. Make sure you're present at the third webinar, where I will present the impact of temperature, pitching rate, and word gravity, original gravity, on the flavor profile of the beer. Okay, thanks, Len. So I think there are no more questions. I wish everyone a great weekend. Make sure to stay safe. Enjoy brewing if you plan to brew this weekend. And I hope to see you next week. Maybe one last remark is, if all works well, you will get an email tomorrow. With a link to the recording of this webinar. So if you want to watch it back, that's possible. Okay, guys, have a great weekend. Bye-bye.